Listening Library presents I Will Never Leave You by Kara A. Kennedy. Read for you by Brittany Pressley. For Mom and Grandmom and all the other unbreakable girls. I am the hermit. I search for bones as the hawk circles above my head. My light is soft and low, illuminating just as far ahead as is required for my eyes to see. This walk is mine alone. You are not invited where I am going. Anna Marie Tendler. Prologue. No one knows Alana Murray like I do. I was the one who held her hand on the first day of sixth grade, secret, so no one would know she was nervous. I was the one who edited her English papers for her. I was the one who kissed her behind a palm tree when we were 15, my heart cracking out of my ribcage. I'll be the last person to touch her casket before it's lowered into the ground. Funeral day dawns dark and cold and wrong. The Los Angeles sky clogged with watercolor gray. It won't rain, and I won't let myself cry. I practice in front of my bathroom mirror. Alana died alone, I think, staring at my reflection until my eyes burn. She thought of you every second, how she hated you, how she loved you. I sob until my throat goes dry, until I gag into the sink, fingernails scraping against the marble countertop. Then I wipe my makeup off with a warm washcloth, reapply my mascara, start all over. Alana always thought I cried too much. So today, I won't let the tears come. Even though I know what people will say about a girl who doesn't cry at her own girlfriend's funeral. Monster. Heartless. I am. But not for the reasons they think. During the service, Alana's mom wears sunglasses with her black Chanel dress and ignores me. Lilies choke the inside of the funeral home. Everyone else watches me, whispers about me. Maya. The wind hisses my name. Maya, what do you know? I can feel it, a slow, creeping hate I might never outrun. Outside, it's a sea of dark clothes and soft sniffles under shady trees. A small pile of red roses laid across the top of the casket. We surround Alana's gravesite, and I can feel how the others loathe me because they think I know too much or too little. They track my movements, and it feels like ice water dripping down my back. Finally, everyone turns away, and the weight of their stares lifts. The cedar of Alana's casket is warm under my palm, and I try to remember the way it felt to loop a strand of her hair around my finger, to brush my knuckles across her lips. A handful of orange California poppy petals slip through my fingertips and scatter across the coffin lid. When I turn my back, I allow myself the smallest of smiles. Because I know better than anyone that death isn't the end. Not for Alana and me. Not even close. Chapter 1. 1 week earlier. On the morning I decide to break up with Alana, the sky is crystal blue. We're hiking the Superbloom Trail at Antelope Valley, our annual tradition. Liquid gold sunlight pours down on us, warming the pathway lined with electric orange poppies bending in the wind. The gusts are almost strong enough to block out the obliterating desert heat. I was praying for rain last night, for a miracle that would cancel this outing, but the Southern California air is dry as ever. "You're so tense and weird today," Alana says. She never breathes heavily on hikes. Everything she does, from schoolwork to hiking to insulting me, is effortless. "Sorry." I take a swig from my water bottle while her back is turned. "I'm just stressed." "Maya," What do you have to be stressed about? Her brown ponytail swings. It's a beautiful day. You're surrounded by wildflowers. Senior year's basically over. You have me. Relax. I tilt my head back to face the sky. An eagle swoops overhead, low and silent. People come to see the famous super bloom from all over, cars lining the roads that feed to the visitor center. Ever since we got our licenses, we've made the trip up here each May. It's our thing. If I break up with her, I leave all that behind. I start all over again. It's what I need to do. I just don't know if I'm strong enough to stand up to her. On the trail, it's quiet, but there are still plenty of hikers snapping photos and laughing. Everyone in the world is happier than me. At least there will be witnesses, I tell myself glumly, wiping the sweat off my forehead. Because I know what will happen when I initiate this conversation with Alana. Her anger, the way it accelerates so quickly, it makes me dizzy. I can already feel the fear lodging in my throat, the kick drum beat of my heart. Are you freaking out about graduation? Alana asks, voice cutting through the quiet. Because it won't be a big deal. We'll walk across the stage, we'll get our diplomas. Barely, in my case. I bite my lip and focus on the California poppies spilling out before us. Graduation is next Saturday, only a week away. That whole thing is still a secret, right? You didn't tell anybody? Alana turns, walking backward, bouncing on the soles of her feet. Her sneakers are newer than mine, pristine despite the dirt path. Everything she touches stays perfect. Who would I tell? She asks. Besides, it's your personal business. And everyone else on the planet when I stay here in LA this fall, I mumble, kicking a pebble. It ricochets off my sneaker, lands in a cluster of poppies and blue forget-me-nots. Do you know how shitty it feels, not getting into a single college? She pauses, waits for me to catch up. Beyond her is a sprawling wildflower field that goes on for miles. And in the distance, the white-capped San Gabriel Mountains. I swallow back that gnawing sensation I get at the sight of it. I've lived in Southern California my whole life, and it never fails to knock me off my feet. There was a time when I felt the same way whenever I looked at Alana. Now, the expectant set of her mouth floods my stomach with nausea, the copper taste of fear in my mouth bitten back. You're being dramatic, Alana says. Hardly anybody gets into Yale early decision. That was always a crapshoot. This is a well-trodden conversation, one we've revisited 100 times over the past few months. And then what? 5 rejection letters during regular decision? Something like that, I say. Like I don't know the names of the schools by heart. Like I don't recite them over and over in my head in a mantra of self-hatred before falling asleep. Well, it could have been worse. Alana squeezes my hand, and the knot in my chest loosens. Alana is nice to me. She is. This is proof. Nobody in our class knows besides me. So you show up at the graduation ceremony and act like you have every right to be there because you do. Be brave. I don't know if I remember how to do brave things, I think, wiping the back of my hand across my sweaty forehead and squinting into the Mojave Desert sun. It's almost impossible to believe that wildflowers can bloom in an environment like this. Alana crouches down at the trail's edge as a couple of hikers holding hands with a giggling toddler pass behind us. I watch her brush her fingers gently against the soft petal of a poppy. Speaking of college, my throat constricts. Sunlight picks strands of gold out of Alana's deep brown hair. I was thinking that it doesn't. She mumbles something under her breath. It sounds like, here we go. What? I ask, defensive. You're going to give me a big speech about how we shouldn't be together, right? Because long distance will be too hard. I'm silent. She glances over her shoulder. Am I wrong? I just don't see how it can work, I whisper. You being all the way on the East Coast for college. I mean, it's ridiculous, right? She's going to say I'm wrong, I tell myself, hope blooming in my chest. She'll tell me that distance doesn't matter. Or better yet, she won't go to Massachusetts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.